Hello, everybody. My name is Armin Wolf. I'm the Chief Scientific Officer of Insphero. My background is toxicology, pharmacology in drug development. Today, I'm going to talk about human 3D microtissues in translational toxicology and disease modeling. Before I'm coming to show that topic, I would like to give an introduction of Insphero. Insphero is a global company having sites in the US and in Switzerland, in Zurich. It was founded 10 years ago, and it is a pioneer in 3D microtissue bioengineering and development of platforms and technology, and also the current market leader. The focus of Insphero is liver, islet, and tumor microtissues, and particularly for providing customized application in drug discovery and translational toxicology. Insphero is providing assays ready for solution services, consulting, R&D for new model development, and among the top 10 pharma companies, they are collaborating with Insphero. Today, I'm divided my talk into two major parts. It's the translational safety part, and I will give an example of the DILI, the drug-induced liver injury. And I will talk in the second part of the disease modeling, and we'll use the NASH, the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, as an example. In the end, I will have an outlook and talk about the challenges and opportunities. This is the life cycle of the drug discovery process and of a potential drug. It starts by 10,000 compounds and ends up in one approved drug. This process is divided into two big major parts, which is the research discovery part and the development part. The first part, the research and discovery, is focusing on the drug efficacy to find out an efficacious drug. And the second part is foreseen, particularly the preclinical part, to predict in vitro safety as well as to have safety animal studies done before you go into the first in human. This is about 10-year process, which costs about between 2 and 3 billion US dollar. So there's a lot of attrition from the first step to the last step. One important attrition factor for this process is the drug-induced liver injury, the DILI, and it can be diagnosed by when a living organism is treated by a drug. It can be diagnosed by histopathology, and there are classical histopathological changes like cholestasis, steatosis, fibrosis, hepatitis, necrosis, and apoptosis, which are part of that phenotype. The preclinical attrition is after the treatment of animals, and depending on the company and on the chemistry of that company, whether the DILI is causing a high rate of attrition or a lower rate of attrition. An average is about between 30% and 45%. When a compound passes the preclinical testing, then it can, and there are safety factors, then it can go into the first in human trials, and it is supposed to be safe in terms of toxicity. But sometimes the observation is made that in the clinical phase, in the clinical testing phase two and three, the so-called Hy's Law cases are observed, or there are some signs for liver intolerability. Even if this does not happen, then it is happening several times and multiple times that in the clinics there are some signals of so-called idiosyncratic DILI observed, which finally are leading to the withdrawals from the markets. What are additional challenges of during the drug development process that has been shown by the EMEA, who published in 2018, in the end of 2018, that about 90% of all the compounds would are declared as IND and are ready for the first testing and were tested in the clinical stages, that they failed. This is the reality, 90%, it can be explained by the lack of translation of the animal studies, as well as of the models which are used for making here some efficacy or safety predictions. So there's a tremendous need to improve the translation to man, and there are some promising development in the field of the model development, particular in the 3D microtissue arena, which gives here some hope that there is some opportunities for research and development, and also in the discovery as well as in the safety arena. What are the special features of a 3D microtissue, and what makes the tissue so successful? The microtissues, they appear as spheres. You can see one in the right upper panel. It's about 200 micrometer diameter. It contains about 2,000 cells. It's the smallest functional unit of the liver. It's a co-culture. It consists not only on hepatocytes, but also on liver endothelial cells, Kupffer cells, and stellate cells. The morphology and the special function and the metabolic activity of these spheroids are maintained. That can be shown graphically in a heat map where native liver and 3D cultures were compared, and there is no difference between those two. However, when you look on 2D cultures, cultured for 24 hours or even longer, they're completely changing their phenotype in terms of the proteomic activities. This comes from the way how the spheroids are constructed. It's based on self-assembling. Instead of attaching to a surface, they can contact each other cell by cell, and they're secreting extracellular matrix, which then gives this outcome in terms of the functionality and the morphology. These microspheres, they have a high lifetime, so the longevity of about 28 days enables multiple chronic treatment at low dosages. So the treatment in patients or in animals can be mimicked on a daily basis or another, depending on the treatment schedule. This gives a robust, scalable output. There is some possibility to do these experiments at 96 well format as a 384 plate format. So there's one tissue in one well, and it's really awesome. The supernatant for that is about 70 microliter, which is not that much, but it still enables to do all these experiments, biochemical, cellular, biomarker measurements, high content imaging, and omics, and so on. This is now showing what in detail can be measured for some investigative targets of the DILI development. And there are several endpoints from morphology till molecular endpoint, which can be measured under these conditions. I don't want to go into the details, but it shows that this is a huge spectra of possibility which can be applied for under the 3D liver microtissue conditions. I'm just coming now to the translational part and explaining that based on Dili. There are two major blocks which can be used for Dili investigation. It's the predictive toxicology part, which is to identify hazards, which is the screening part to select at an early phase compounds which causing Dili and to rank them. This is a data science part. It's based on correlation statistics, and it will deliver some specificity and sensitivity of compounds. And the second big block is the mechanistic part, which is evidence-based science, and it's depending on individual cases. It determines the sequence of events when a compound study inducing Dili, and it's validating the pathways. The first application I would like to mention is the screening purpose, and here on this slide you see the comparison between 2D primary hepatocyte cultures and 3D liver microtissues. In the red circles, you see the effects of some selected compounds which do not have an effect under 2D culture conditions, but a strong effect on under the 3D conditions. This shows that the 3D microtissues have a higher sensitivity, and based on the evaluation of 108 clinical compounds, which have different annotation to the Dili scores, it was demonstrated that the 3D has, in fact, twofold higher sensitivity compared to the 2D, whereas the specificity of the two tests remained the same. So this is a clear outcome, which was published by Genentech and AstraZeneca. This assay can be used in an early phase, in the lead optimization phase, in parallel to efficacy testing and helping to select compounds before they are entering into the animal testing phase. The next one is an application for 3D microtissues, which appears or which can be applied after the first animal studies have been done. So when the development transition was made, or just before, that when animal data are available, the principle is to recapitulate the in vivo effects in animals and also on a specific animal model for a specific compound, and testing this compound under the respective model conditions, then also for humans, so that the human result will give you a decision criteria, milestone point, whether a compound can go into the clinics or whether it's stopped at that point. This is an example. That's the classical way how toxicology and pharmacology determine the therapeutic window of a compound. If this window is sufficiently broad enough and there is some risk factors, then there is no reason to stop. Then it's a clear go. When this therapeutic window is shrinking because toxicity appears at too low concentration, then some company make very conservative decisions and stop the whole process. But there's a way just to get clarity and to help to make the decision for the future fate of a compound, and that can be done based on translational experimentations. And I'm showing here in case one, how an in vivo effect was recapitulated by an in vitro model. And compound A, in this case, caused here an ALT increase and central lobular necrosis under in vivo condition as measured by ClinPath. And that effect was translated into an in vitro model by the release of cytosolic enzymes and looking on necrotic marker. And the red square shows that there is a good recapitulation of both effects. So compound number A validates the in vitro model for its specificity. In both systems, the dog was indicating to be the positive species, and the rat was the negative one. And it turned out in under these conditions that the compound effects in the dog is not translatable to man, and that gives a go to move forward with this project. So that helps the internal company project teams to make a decision and to move or to stop a compound. The next example, case number two, shows exactly the opposite. In this case, we have also a good recapturing of the in vivo effects. Here is measured by microvesicular steatosis. In this case, again, the dog was the positive species and the rat was negative. And compound B validates the in vitro models because it's showing the species-specific effects also under in vitro conditions. But in this case, the observation was made that the compound B was also positive under human conditions, which says that the effect is translatable to man. And this is a clear no-go and for this compound. So such a finding also triggers some further mechanistic studies where project team then can further investigate what is the cause for this type of observation and then how to circumvent it by doing extensive quantitative structure activity relationship in the medicinal chemistry space. This is an example of a compound which was withdrawn from the market. It's cytoxanthine. it showed also some effects in human after successful registration. And this is a retrospective evaluation using the 3D models and comparing the different rat, dog, monkey, and rat head to head. And in this case, it turns out that the human model was indicating a higher toxicity for the cytoxanthine and other species that were less sensitive in terms of the effect. So that it's confirming the decision made to withdraw it from the market. So coming now to the third application for the 3D microtissue, and this is in the field of mechanistic toxicology. It starts by the adverse outcome pathway for the DILI, which is a sequence of key events leading to DILI. It's based on existing knowledge. It's starting from the molecular initiation to the cellular responses, organism, and also population responses, which are connected and which can help to explain the DILI phenomenon, and also helping to put some further information into the system to understand it better. It is a structural framework which helps to organize existing data, but it's also helpful for the planning of new experiments. I'm just focusing on the first part of this adverse outcome pathway, which is the molecular initiation part leading to the cellular responses. And there are three major DILI pathways which are well investigated. Yeah, and there are some compounds which have these pathways all in common. And it's indicated here by the different colors. So it's a gray line, and red line and the blue line, and it's starting just by the uptake of a compound into liver cells by the metabolism, and then by the formation of oxidative stress and mitochondrial damage. There are some key event relationships between those two events and then leading to necrosis, apoptosis, or steatosis. So that's an investigated pathway which has been published and discussed among scientists as a cause for DILI. Then there's another pathway which starts by the same paradigm that the parent compound has to be taken up. So, and then can be further metabolized. There's also the possibility for covalent binding, but the parent compound as well as the covalent binding compound or the reactive metabolite can have an effect on the inhibition of the biliary efflux. This is leading to cholestasis, which then gives the accumulating the intracellular bile acids, and by the lipophilicity and the cytotoxicity of these bile acids, necrosis is induced. So that's a major outcome. Then a classical one, which strain which is investigated when it comes to clinical DILI, is the to investigate the TRAC metabolism as a source for reactive metabolite formation, which is leading to covalent binding, inducing adducts to protein, which then can be immune reactive and stimulating T cells activation and cytokine release, and by the inflammatory processes leading to necrosis. So that's a very detailed mechanism which can serve as a roadmap to investigate DILI systematically. So it has to be said that these adverse outcome pathways, as they are published, it's based on available knowledge, what is known in the databases, what it's a summary of many compounds, but it's for new compounds, the situation is a bit different. We have a roadmap which we can investigate, but it doesn't mean that every compound is undergoing the same sequence of events and having also the same pathways involved in the DILI. This has to be explored and investigated, and it's simply starting by the analysis of a finding in an animal study or a clinical study, and we're coming up with a hypothesis which is then leading to a fine-tuned analysis by studying the sequence of events. This gives some indication on the pathways which are involved. These pathways have to be validated, and then it will end up in a specific compound-specific individual AOP. The way to do the sequence events analysis, I think that's clear. Biomarker will be looked at different time points. The validation of the pathways which are involved in the cellular responses goes according to classical pharmacology and toxicology. A pathway will be looked by in presence of an agonist or an antagonist, which is these are mediators just shifting the response. For the DILI, the readout is the cellular ATP, as well as the LDH, which is released from a damaged membrane. And a particular compound's effect will be then investigated in the presence of an agonist or as an antagonist, an inhibitor or an enhancer. And then if a shift is occurred, a significant shift is occurred, then this indicates two causal relationship between pathway modification and the cellular response. So this shows again our roadmap for the DILI with the three streams. And this shows where causality assays can be placed in as markers to study the validity of those pathways for the mode of action of these compounds. I would like to give an example of such an evaluation, and it's based on the fact that a drug is metabolized by the CYP system or other biotransformation step to reactive metabolite, which then can bind to protein, and the protein binding is then leading to toxicity. That's a rough, rough pathway. This doesn't happen under normal conditions because the cellular glutathione level is relatively high. Glutathione is an endogenous nucleophilic agent, which is chemically reacting to electrophiles, and by that scavenging, just inactivating the reactivity and the toxicity of that compound. So glutathione is also very important to detoxify reactive oxygen species. In classical peroxidase reaction, reactive oxygen species like hydrogen peroxide can be detoxified, and this would not lead then to toxicity. So, but under special conditions, when the glutathione level is decreasing, the effect of the toxicity of a compounds for reactive metabolite formation and ROS formation can be sensitized and can be determined. So there's a way to do that experimentally, and we do that with the with the BSO, which is a glutathione synthesis inhibitor. And you see on the right side of the blue arrow that the BSO is really decreasing by inhibiting the glutathione synthesis, the level of glutathione. And it's also important to mention that under those conditions, the BSO is not cytotoxic. Now, such an assay model can be applied also in parallel to the testing of compounds. And we are using here the acetaminophen, the APAP, under the plus and minus BSO. And you clearly can see that BSO is shifting the effect to lower concentration, which means sensitizing the effect. And we did that here at the level of the cellular ATP, which is counting the viable cells. And on the right side, you see the release of lactate dehydrogenase, which is released when this cellular membrane is damaged, and it can then release into the cell culture supernatant. So this is showing the proof of concept, and it shows that the depletion of glutathione can demonstrate reactive oxygen formation as well as reactive drug metabolite formation. This has also been shown with a handful of other compounds, and I'm just highlighting the ticlopidine, which gives the same response. It's also withdrawn from the market based on adduct formation, and it gives exactly the same response, showing reactive metabolite formation. In a nutshell, what can we do with this causality assays? These causality assays can be used to demonstrate Dilly-specific mechanistic changes of a compound, to go here for deconvolution of mechanistic questions. So what is the mechanism of the Dilly formation? It also helps if someone wants to screen out some of the mechanistic properties of a new compound, and doing here some QSAR and going extensively into some quantitative structure activity relationship. I'm now coming to the applications in toxicology. I'm coming also on to highlight the impact which the investigations have in drug development. And I put these positive features of 3D microtissues together in one column. And the value, in fact, comes from the high impact comes from the fact that these investigations are leading to fast decision making in the drug development process. So that can be done at the level of the predictive toxicology by the hazard identification in an early phase, just circumventing cleaning the pipeline until it comes into the full development and the first studies in animals are done. But then if those in vivo observations were made, the translational part helps here also to make decisions based in either direction to stop a project or to promote a project. Then the mechanistic studies are helpful to understand the mode of action, particular for the backup programs, which will continue then, which are getting important when a drug fail in the pipeline, and also to explore on and off target effects and selecting the toxic GLP species, the right GLP species. So this all has also a positive impact on the three R's. Now, what is the benefit for the clinics? It's not only that 3D microtissues can be successfully applied in the toxicology. They have also an effect in the clinics, particularly when you imagine that when a compound passes all development steps from non-clinical into clinical, that the compound is considered to be non-toxic, it is tolerated by human, and that's part of the risk assessment. But when you look on the reality, it is that there will be some there are some cases which escape the risk assessment made by toxicology, and that can be explained by the fact that DILI is not a single event. It has some risk factors which are all contributing to the formation of the DILI, and those risk factors are shifting the curve therapeutic window from a broad range. It can change if the factors coming together into the therapeutic range. How can 3D micro tissues help here? That's in the next slide. And on the left side, you see the clinical need, the possible application. And one application is to make a better risk assessment for patient with the underlying specific diseases. Risk assessment in toxicology is made by healthy animals for patients, but I think in the last years, it's more and more understood that the risk is also contributing to the risk. The risk assessment is underlying the disease, the genotype, and so on of those risk factors. And this is shifting the curves. And in order to make a right risk assessment, microtissues can help here to make here the comparison and to determine the fragile conditions of a patient. There's another application which is also coming from the clinics. It's the stratification of patients in order to make the clinical outcome more clear, knowing that there are different types of population involved, and that gives sometimes a very unclear outcome. And that's based on polymorphism. That's also based on different ethnicities. And this is a factor which can also be investigated further with the microtissues. It can be considered for toxicity as well as for efficacy testing. So if a clinical DILI case occurs, then the genome-wide association study are done, and they come up with hypotheses, sometimes with unclear hypotheses, but it depends on the number of the patients. But knowing these underlying genotype, it's also possible to select microtissues and to submit them for in vitro testing. So individualized patient can be also addressed by the use of iPS-derived tissues. The idiosyncratic DILI is mainly immune-mediated, so co-cultures of PBMCs with microtissues can appear. In particular, it has to be paid attention to the HLA match of the PBMCs and the 3D tissue donor. That can be done by matching it to the HLA type, but also it is possible to take PBMCs together with from the same and the microtissue from the same donor. So there's also the possibility that the PBMCs in the case of a clinical DILI response can be taken from the responders and compare then the microtissue effects then compared to non-responder. This all gives a very nice toolbox to investigate it, also clinical safety. And there are some mechanistic investigations possible, which are coming also which are triggered by the clinics, which is, for instance, the de-risking of the highs and low cases. Not every time when increase of bilirubin and ALT are observed, it does mean that this is a damaged liver is causing the increase of the bilirubin. And sometimes it's a transporter problem and impairment of transporter. And that can also be studied by the help from the 3D microtissue. Biomarkers strategy can be built on, and also antidote development can be made by a microtissue. Last but not least, this is a very important activity with a high impact, is just to provide mechanistic explanation to the health authorities, to the FDA, as the EMA. And that can be done from the beginning on by the submissions, but also sometimes health authorities have questions, and it's important that these questions are answered in a very high qualitative manner, and also in a fast manner. And the microtissues can help here too. I'm now coming to the disease modeling part, as explained by the NASH. NASH is a disease. It's the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. It's developing from NAFLD, non-alcoholic fatty liver diseases. So 25% of the U.S. population has NAFLD, and about 30% develop NASH. And from the NASH, people having NASH, 20% again developing cirrhosis. So there's already from the population diagnostics, it's clear that we have a progression from the NAFLD to NASH and to the fibrosis. And that's also the confirmed pathogenesis of those diseases. There's a tremendous need. There's a specific pathogenesis, the progression of the disease from fatty liver to the cirrhotic, fibrotic state. And it's a fact that this pathogenesis cannot be modeled and mimicked by animals as it is in man. And it's also turned out that the 2D models do not reflect all the mechanisms and the disease progression states as they are occurring in humans. So that explained to some extent that there is no drug on the market yet. These are the potential targets which are currently explored because of the high market value. There are a lot of companies trying to move into that area and to develop here a potential truck. There is no truck on the market, and the final proof of concept has also to be established and demonstrated at the clinical end. Now, this is an now the situation where we believe that we have something new in our hand. So this is a 3D disease model for NASH. It's constructed in a way that it has all the components which play a role in the NASH pathogenesis. There are different types of cells involved in that. It's not only the hepatocytes, it's a Kupffer cell, it's the hepatic stellate cells, and also the endothelial cells could play a role. And the progression state can indeed be monitored then by the different layers of available endpoints. Importantly, the disease can be stimulated by dietary factors like free fatty acids, inflammatory markers, and sugar. And it's based on the fact that there is some interaction between the cells at the stage that they then stimulating then the next progression state. And that's what is the outcome of this model. For the testing of compounds, there is some incubation during the NASH formation where anti-inflammatory and anti-fibrotic and metabolic factors can be investigated. So this is a physiological relevant one with model which is tunable and where it's makes results first and efficient available in a under the screening conditions. Now this shows again the adverse outcome pathway of the NASH. This is the in vivo outcome of the progression of the disease. And below you see the modeling of the disease under in vitro conditions. And it's the whole disease can be squeezed into the development within 10 days. And here the hallmarks of the disease progression can be established, like steatosis, the inflammatory responses, and the pro-fibrogenic stages. Again, here the effect can be monitored under the in the presence of the NASH conditions when a compound will be incubated together with the NASH factors. And the next slide shows the different hallmarks of the disease. And this is here the lipid loading phase after 10 days to control and to NASH. Steroids are measured by NIRED, which shows the accumulation of fat. Lipids and in the right slide, you see the triglyceride formation in those spheroids as they are accumulating then over time. Another hallmark is the inflammatory response of the NASH, which is indicated by increased cytokine and chemokine markers. These are significantly different markers from which are different from the under the control conditions. Even there are some markers which you cannot be measured because they are so low expressed, but under the NASH conditions, they are showing up and showing some significant increases. So one important marker after 10 days is the procollagen type 1 secretion indicating the pro-fibrogenic states. It also shows in this graph that the NASH under cool incubation with an ALK5 inhibitor, that this process can be inhibited. So this is a significant change, and the window between control and NASH is significantly high to see here well-graduated effects of testing of test compounds. This is a proof of concept for the at the level of the triglyceride formation, a compound which is also tested in the clinic. It's a pharoscostat, which is decreasing the level of triglycerides significantly. It's a selinocertib, which is also decreasing the inflammatory markers, in this case, the IL-6 and the TNF-alpha significantly. Summarizing all the observation, the NASH model is a complex model. It's a co-culture model, which allows the interaction of the different types of cells which are involved in the pathogenesis of the disease. They're recapitulating the phenotypes of the disease progression very well. And the hallmarks were clearly demonstrated here for the steatosis, inflammation, and the fibrosis. The proof of concept was also shown by compounds, model compounds for ALK5 inhibitor, as well as for the triglyceride decreasing and inflammatory marker, which were increased and finally decreased by the compounds with compounds like fusocostat and selinocertib. So this is a robust assay. It shows some scalability, highest level of scalability, and also feasibility for high throughput format screening assays. So just coming to the challenges, as mentioned before, the current toxicity and the testing paradigm is based on healthy animals, particularly in the tox field, where predictions are made between healthy animals and the to patients. So the expected outcome is translation, and knowing that patients is not a very homogenized population, knowing that some of the new modalities, which are mainly coming from the biologics field, they cannot be evaluated under the standard traditional or historical rules of toxicology by using animals. Even monkeys, they are not close enough to man. This requires some patient tissue in order to make here some prediction which is relevant to man, and the 3D systems can help here. So these new modalities, as well as customized solution to identify population as well as individual patients, can be evaluated under those conditions. These are the challenges put together. The new therapeutic modalities are biologics. They're coming from the field of monoclonal antibodies, monoclonal bispecific antibodies, recombinant proteins. Gene therapy is a challenge. Stem cell therapy, as well as immune-mediated DILI, is a challenge which requires the further development of the in vitro models towards immunological competence. And I presented already the possibilities for PBMCs to put them on the plates, and using then also stimulation of T cells specifically to determine the outcome then under these conditions. So in the field of predictive toxicology, the transcriptomics plays a more and more important role. It turned out that the way how big data analyzed also are useful tools for the transcriptomics. and particular in 3D conditions, the transcriptomics can be useful to generate here some algorithms of the, for DILI by having a data set which allows them to do that. Another challenge is the single-cell genomics. So there are some efforts ongoing to go from the bulk approach to the single-cell approach, and some efforts are successful. In the field of gene editing, which is important as a mechanistic tool and also as a target identification and validation tool, it's used as the vectors are used also in the gene therapy, particularly the adeno-associated viruses, which then can induce toxicity by itself. So there's a need to explore and to understand that better. There's also a way to do here more in terms of siRNA, microRNA, and oligonucleotide treatment. The organ-on-a-chip is currently explored. There are multiple platforms available for applications in pharma, and also in order to deconvolute or to mimic some models, some specific important questions. It's the purpose to go here for pragmatic approaches, to get things done in an easy, simple way. And I think the InSphero platform is constructed that it could help here also to answer easy and simple questions, and to get here some pragmatic solutions which are adapted to the underlying scientific question. The microbiome is certainly a big challenge for the whole scientific field. One has to consider that these processes happen in the bacteria, and when bacteria are brought into cell culture, this is not a very incompatible situation. But the metabolites which are formed by certain bacteria can also be incubated and monitored under the 3D conditions. So just in summary, the 3D liver microtissues, when applied in drug development, they have an impact on safety assessment and on drug discovery processes. The models fulfill the demands in terms of translatability to man, and even not healthy man preaching to patients. It's allowing to make here patient-centric evaluations. The 3D human liver microtissue applications can be used pragmatically, having a high level of flexibility. They can be adapted easily under the underlying specific scientific conditions. The 3D microtissues are complex model which are amenable to high throughput. So this is also something which is new in the field, that this gives data with high quality. It shows the robustness and the scalability of the results. And finally, the 3D technology is accessible also to the as an investigative tool to the upcoming challenges for the next generation of therapeutic modalities, and that makes it so attractive. I would like to thank also my colleagues who contributed to the slides and to the data. Thank you very much.